ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानञ्जनशलाकाय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः.
Sages of Silicon Valley, Hare Krishna. Welcome, everybody. It's a good idea to come see Krishna because he's the main one to see in the anywhere. Just by seeing Krishna, one perfects one's eyes. And Krishna very kindly appears in this world in various ways so that we can see him. And then in the Bhagavad Gita, he recommends that we think of him. Manmana bhava mad bhakto. Madhyaji mam namaskuru. Mami vaishyas yukt vaivam atmanam aparayanaha. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, just think of me. So if one sees Krishna regularly, one can think of Krishna easily. And throughout the 11th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam and elsewhere, Krishna in his instructions to Uddhava recommends that in the process of meditation, one fix one's mind on the form of the Lord. The Lord has a beautiful form. And there are very specific features of that form. When one becomes accustomed to those features and fixes one's mind on them, this is the essence of meditation. So, it's so pleasant to see you all here today who have come to see Krishna in this ISKCON of Silicon Valley, which is International Society for Krishna Consciousness. There are various ways in which one can conduct one's business in this life, how one can organize one's life. And the guiding principles for this society, which is an international society, is to keep one's attention on Krishna's instructions by actively carrying them out. And one of the most prominent instructions given by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is accepted by the great acharyas like Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, Jiva Goswami, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, Baladev Vidyabhusan, to be the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself, is to regularly, if not constantly, repeat the names of God. This instruction was brought to light by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and you'll find it in the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. We have that book. Someone will bring it and put it on this table. The Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita is a biography of the life of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And within it are his extensive teachings. Part of the biography is a recount of his initiation. When he was a young man, he was a great scholar living in Navadvip. How many here have been to Navadvip? Raise your hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Yeah, I saw you there. We just came back from there last week. We were in Navadvip. Navadvip Dham, it's 9 islands. Each island represents one of the processes of devotional service. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atmanivedanam. These are the 9 principal practices of bhakti. And each one of the islands represents one of those processes. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was a child, lived in Navadvip. And then he went to Gaya. Gaya is a place where the Falguni River runs. How many people have taken a bath in the Falguni River? I'm glad you didn't raise your hand, because that river is made of sand. Actually, the water is underneath. As we get started here, let's try an experiment. Why don't we try moving up a little bit and fill in some of these spaces? If you feel comfortable, come up a little closer. I heard one time that nature abhors a vacuum. Have you ever heard that? Nature abhors a vacuum. Hansapri, you never heard that? Avantika, did you hear that? Nature abhors a vacuum. Abhay, you heard it. They're not teaching that anymore, I guess. Welcome, everyone. Please come in. Make yourselves comfortable. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Gaya. It's a place where people go to perform the Shraddha ceremony. It's a way in which one honors one's forefathers. After a soul leaves the body, especially one performing the duty of one's parent, then one can offer oblations, offer sacrifice, make what they call pinda offerings to benefit that departed soul. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, following the culture, went there to Gaya, and he performed this ceremony to benefit his departed father, Sri Jagannath Mishra. While he was there, he met his spiritual master, Srila Ishwara Puri, who was a pure devotee of Krishna. And Srila Ishwara Puri, because he was a pure devotee, recognized the exalted nature of Nimai Pandit. And Nimai Pandit became immediately attracted to Srila Ishwara Puri and asked him for initiation into the chanting of Hare Krishna mantra and the chanting of the esoteric mantras, beginning with the Gayatri mantra. Srila Ishwara Puri initiated Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as a service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And after receiving that initiation, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came back to Navadvip Dham as a changed person. Before he left, he was a great scholar, as I mentioned, but what I didn't mention was that due to his scholarship, he was considered to be a conceited person, someone who was very much full of himself because of his learning. But when he came back to Navadvip after receiving initiation from his spiritual master, he had become a humble devotee of the Lord. So much so that everywhere he went, he was looking for ways in which he could serve the devotees, carrying water for them, offering them a seat. And not only that, his whole aim in life changed. Rather than being interested in scholarship for its own sake, now he was looking for Krishna everywhere. As mentioned by Srinivasacharya, the mood of the disciples in the line of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not that they were seeing Krishna all the time, but they were always looking for Krishna. This is a mood called Vipralamba, or separation from Krishna, this mood of intense separation. Has anybody here ever felt that for a relative or a friend? I just want to make sure everyone's alive, because anyone who's alive has felt this. There's a natural way in which we become attached to people. Anybody here attached to anybody in their life? Radha Kripa is attached to somebody. The three people in the back. You? Do you have any friends? What's her name? You're on stage now. What's your name? Huh? Ananya. Ananyas chintayanto mam. Ye jana paripashite. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, he put... Your name is from the Bhagavad Gita, Ananya. Did you know that? That's right. It's in the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna says, Ananyas chintayanto mam. One who thinks of me all the time. Do you have any friends, Ananya? You have a friend? I'm Vaish. What's your friend's name? Anusha? Where is she right now? Where? Where is she? Huh? Do you miss her? That's not on. You got to turn it on. Okay.
Hare Krishna.
That'll work.
Anusha's my friend.
Anusha is her friend.
Where is she?
It's on the home.
Do you miss her?
No.
It's all right. She's just covering it up. It's natural to become attached, to have friends, to have loved ones. And this is what really compels people to work in this world, is to maintain these relationships. We have relationships with friends. We have relationships with family members. We have loved ones who are very dear to us. And for this reason, we work very hard in this world. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that all these relationships are natural. It's not that we don't have relationships when we become fully purified and spiritual. In some lines of philosophy, some teachers say that because relationships cause problems, does that resonate with you? Have you ever had problems from relationships? A couple of people smiling. A couple of people raising their hands. Relationships can be troublesome also, right? They can actually be very disturbing, catastrophic even. And even in the best of times, when we have perfect relationships, then we are separated from them by time. We're separated by loss of loved one, someone dies, moves on, and then we have a heavy heart. And one who observes how this world is full of relationships that are broken or that become soured after some time may then think, well, the opposite of that is to have no relationship at all, and therefore I'll eliminate relationships, and that when I become perfect in spiritual life, there won't be such a thing. But this is not what Krishna teaches in the Bhagavad Gita. In fact, he says in the Gita, vitaraga bhaya krodha, that one must overcome the fear of personal relationships. But one should understand that there are pure relationships in spiritual life. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that we have an eternal relationship with Krishna, and we have eternal relationship with Krishna's associates in the spiritual world. And that the same kind of intense feelings that we have for mother, for father, for friends, for children, for lovers in this world. When I say the names of these relationships, perhaps you can see in your mind's eye the various relationships that you have. When I say mother, who do you think of? And how intensely do you think of your mother? And if your mother is not living anymore, do you miss her? Your father, your children, your friends, if you have a lover. These are all tangible for us in this world. In fact, this is the main feature of the world. If you take away these relationships, we have really no impetus to work hard in the world. Srila Prabhupada makes this claim in the beginning of his book, Nectar of Devotion, that we all work hard to maintain these kinds of relationships. That's why we work. If they weren't there, there'd be really no impetus. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that these relationships are a reflection of our real relationship with Krishna. And the process of bhakti means to reawaken our relationship with Krishna in various moods. For instance, one can become a servant of Krishna. One can become a friend of Krishna. There are various kinds of friends. There are very casual friends that Krishna has, and there are friends who are more official. In other words, some of them have more respect for Krishna than others. When I say have more respect, it means that they see him more as a great person, whereas some of his more casual friends, they see him as equal to themselves, and they play with him in Goloka Vrindavan. And you'll read about this in the Srimad Bhagavatam, how Krishna's various friends play with him with the sense that you and I are equal. And sometimes they wrestle. And they'll wrestle Krishna to the ground. Now, in some conceptions of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, this is unheard of. In Vaikuntha, where the Lord is worshipped with great awe and reverence, the idea that one would wrestle with God and pin him to the ground and say, okay, I got you that time, is actually blasphemous. But in the Srimad Bhagavatam, which is especially brought out in this book, the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is a condensation of the Srimad Bhagavatam. This book, the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, is a garland of the most important verses from the Srimad Bhagavatam strung together to give the most practical teachings of the Bhagavatam that we can apply in our daily lives. That's why this book, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, is one of the foremost books of the International Society for Krishna Consciousness. This is where we derive the teachings that we present to people all over the world that have become so popular. Now millions of people are following the process that is put forth by the International Society for Krishna Consciousness, given by its founder, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, who is essentially bringing forth the teachings of the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's teachings show us that there are practical ways in which to revive our relationship with Krishna. And this is the purpose of bhakti, the practice of bhakti yoga. From whatever situation one is in now, by adhering to the tenets of bhakti yoga in one's daily life, living right here in Silicon Valley, whatever township, if you live in an apartment, that's okay, it doesn't matter. If you live in a house, big house, that's okay too. You can also live, where else could you live? Under a bridge, in a van, down by the river, you could live in various places. And from any of those places, the teachings that are given in this book, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, show how to apply the principles of the Bhagavatam in modern day times, so that one gradually reawakens one's relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead in one of four ways: as a feeling of a servant of Krishna, a friend of Krishna, a parent, or a lover of Krishna. These are natural relationships that awaken by the process of bhakti. There are nine basic processes. The first one's called shravanam, and shravanam means to hear. There's a lot of emphasis throughout all the teachings of the Vedas of hearing. In fact, the Vedas themselves are called Shruti. Shruti means that which is heard. And just as the Kehoe salmon, which you will hear a lot about here in California, because it's one of the important links in our ecosystem here in California, the Kehoe salmon, biologists know that when the quiche salmon population is doing well, the ecology is also well balanced. And when they're starting to diminish, they start to worry. It's a link that could be, when lost, catastrophic. I saw a ranger once in Muir Woods who was taking little pieces of trash out of the river that runs through the woods. And I asked him what he was doing. He said he's taking micro trash out of the water because it obscures the sense of smell of the fish to find their original home. And what happens is those fish are born in the river, and then at a certain time their body starts to naturally change, and then they become attracted to the ocean spontaneously. And they swim downstream, they go into the ocean, and of course biologists spend their time tracking these fish. That's what they do. They put a little tracer tag on them so they can electronically trace them. They find that they swim thousands of miles. And then after a couple of years in the big ocean, those fish, even when thousands of miles away, come back to the original river that led them to the ocean, and they swim upstream. And they go all the way back to the original pond in the stream in which they were born. And the ranger told us that those little pieces of trash in the water can obstruct the guidance system of the fish. They can't smell their home. And that's how they find their way home. And I did a little research. The biologists have experimented by, anyway, I don't want to go into it, but they plug the smelling properties of the fish, and then they find that they can't find their way home. So in a similar way, the Vedas are called Shruti. It is a basic principle of any spiritual teaching that we are in an unnatural state in the material world. And to put it in the vernacular, we've lost our way. However, just as those fish can find their way back to their home, in a similar way, not using our smelling, but using our hearing. That sense, the Vedas say, is particularly acute for the human being. And simply by hearing the sounds that come from the spiritual world, which are the Vedic sounds, especially the Bhagavad Gita and the Srimad Bhagavatam and the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is a condensation of the Srimad Bhagavatam and the Bhagavad Gita, then one can triangulate. That is, one can find one's way back to one's original home. Have any of you ever traveled extensively and then felt weary while you were traveling? Raise your hand if you've ever felt weary while you're traveling. You know what weary means? What does weary mean? We don't have our normal personnel in the front row here. But Shambhalangi will look it up. The Srimad Bhagavatam says travelers sometimes become weary. Have you ever felt weary? You have to know what weary means first, right? Okay, here it is. Give her a microphone. Here it comes, right behind you. Tired, it has the element of being tired. I think there's a little more to it. Let's hear it, Shambhalangi.
So feeling or showing tiredness, especially as a result of excessive exertion or lack of sleep.
What else?
Reluctant to see or experience any more of. Tired of.
Okay, where does it come from?
Old English, werig, werig.
Which all. Means what?
It means weary, that's all.
It means weary, tired. Any of you traveled for a long period of time, stuck in an airport somewhere, probably O'Hare Airport? Couldn't get the flight out. There's no place to sit. They're playing music all the time. You don't like the music. There's nothing to eat. Yes or yes? Yes. What other airport were you stuck in? Where? Kolkata. Kolkata. Ever been stuck in Kolkata airport? You stay, your flight leaves at 1 o'clock in the morning. You have to get there at 11. And then people are standing around waiting because three people have to check your ticket. I don't know why three. Why not just one? It's an Indian thing. You can get weary after some time. So Srimad Bhagavatam says we become weary in the material world after wandering. Brahmanda Brahmate means that from one universe to the next, we're simply wandering. These universes are like airports. You go from one airport to the next. Nothing really much to eat. There's nothing to see. Same old music playing over and over again. It's a very a drab place, the material world, just like an airport. I mean, they try to fix it up a little bit, but fixing up an airport's like putting lipstick on a pig. So like, yeah, lipstick looks nice. It's still a pig, though. I'm still not home. So the whole material world's, we try to dress it up and make it look a little more presentable. During the winter time, everyone puts up lights here in America. They put up, we call holiday lights, Christmas lights. And it's like, okay, that looks a little better. Lipstick on a pig. It's not enough to satisfy the soul. So the Bhagavatam says only one thing can satisfy the weary mind and heart of a traveler, and that is going home. As soon as you go home and you close the door and your loved ones come in and the food, you don't have to ask what's in it. You just sit down and say, here, eat this, and you just eat. As you know, they know what to put in it. They know, you know that it's wholesome, healthy. And you know that you can be yourself there. So in the same way, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, this book which is a condensation of the Bhagavatam and the Bhagavad Gita, the most important and most esoteric book offered anywhere in the world on the teachings of spirituality, the Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, presents that our only option for real happiness is this home going. And home going means you have to be home knowing. You have to know where is the home. And really, home is there within the heart. Because if your heart feels satisfied, if you've developed your relationship with Krishna, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, one who sees me everywhere and sees everything within me is never lost to me, and I'm never lost to him. We're always together. That's why the overarching solution to all problems in this world is Krishna consciousness. And that's why our founder, Acharya, named this society the International Society for Krishna Consciousness as a panacea. Panacea means a medicine that cures all ills. Most medicines in this world cause more problems than the original disease. That's why when they present medicines nowadays, they'll tell you the benefits for about 2 minutes, and then for the next half an hour, as required by law, they'll tell you that it causes dry mouth, cracking feet, possible heart attack, insanity, and they go on and on. And so you could take the medicine, it may cure your disease, or it may cause you intense misery in many other ways. Our doctor in the front row is laughing because she knows. She deals probably with pharmaceuticals and pharmaceutical salespeople from all over the world. But this medicine is flawless. And so Shravanam is a kind of medicine that Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, the teachings of Lord Chaitanya, brings forward and shows us will cure whatever pinching and anomalies are troubling us in this world. So Shravanam begins with hearing spiritual sound vibration. And the best of all sound vibrations are the personal names of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. in the science of Sankirtan, that is the glorification of God through singing, it's a very practical process. As we can see in this world, musicians are honored everywhere. In fact, they're worshipped. When we see musicians who have touched our hearts because of their lyrics and their music, we often get chills. We want to see them. When I was a child, I remember I went to the airport to see off my Uncle Alex. He was flying home. And the Beatles had been there in the airport about an hour before us. And the entourage was just leaving. And my brother and I practically worshiped that airport from then on. So music is a way that the heart is easily touched. And so Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita gives the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the various ways in which the musical presentation of God's personal names and not only opens the heart, but it purifies us of all the obstructions that hold us back from the unadulterated love for God and for reawakening that original relationship we have. In fact, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu teaches in this book that by regularly repeating the names of God and singing them, one extinguishes what he calls the forest fire of material existence. He compares this world to a burning forest, and we're stuck in it. There's no stopgap measure for putting out a forest fire. It has to rain. That's the only way. So this chanting of God's names is like that downpour which puts out the forest fire, he says. And he also says, from it arises knowledge. In fact, he says you'll be married to knowledge, real knowledge, which means knowledge that makes you spiritually alert in this world, that allows you to see the difference between what is valuable and what is merely a fleeting fancy. The Bhagavad Gita says, Kshetrajnam chapi mam vidhi sarva kshetrishu bharata. Kshetra kshetrajnoyo jnanam yatach jnanam atam mama. This is Krishna's words. He says that real knowledge is to be able to see the difference between the body and the soul, the atma, the eternal self. There is a principle that animates this body. And when it leaves the body is no longer attractive. We no longer even want it around, even if it's a loved one. As soon as the loved one leaves the body, then we take all cares to remove the body. In Vedic culture, we burn the body same day. For the sun sets, the body is burned. And in secular society, those bodies that were worshipped as great politicians, great musicians, the greatest beauties of this world, there are some legendary beauties of this world. Every country has its list, don't they? Of the most beautiful people. In fact, I see, if I pass the magazine rack at the airport, I see all the time, most attractive person of the year. They use other language, but that's what I'll say. And then that most attractive person of the world, they have some appeal, natural appeal, the way they smile, the way their cheekbones are held. But as soon as there's something very subtle that makes somebody attractive, and people just look at, that's attractive. Even they've done experiments with children. Children, when they show them, babies, I'm saying, they show pictures of people who have more attractive features, and the babies are attracted, and they show them people who are a little more, who are a little less attractive. The babies are not attracted. It's natural. And people generally gravitate towards attractive people. They want to put them in a magazine. They want to look at them, talk about them. Did you see them? What were they wearing? And so forth. But as soon as that spiritual principle leaves the body, and when does it leave? Krishna says in the Gita, ukramantam stitam vapi bunjanam vagunam vitam. When? When he steps out. Is he in? No, he just stepped out. Lights are on, nobody home. In fact, the lights aren't even home on, but if you see someone leave their body, you can tell right away that that principle, that thing that was attractive, it's gone. And the body, in and of itself, cheekbones are still there. The eyelashes, the eyebrow, sometimes it's the eyebrow that gets people. They go, wow, did you see the eyebrows? It can be such a little thing that turns somebody into a supermodel. There's some people, they're models. Some people are, nah, we can't quite use you. You're not quite there yet. And other people, supermodel. Why is it? They just have, it's the eyebrow. It's just a little bit different. It's like, yeah, that's the way I... But as soon as the active principle leaves the body, it's like nobody cares anymore. It's like, no, you keep the body. No. I won't keep, I don't want to stay in the same house, thank you. Otherwise, everyone's trying this. I drove by in Bombay recently. Somebody was Bollywood, where these Bollywood stars stay. There was a whole crowd of people outside. I said, who is that? I wouldn't even recognize the name, I'm happy to say. But everyone was there to see somebody. But as soon as that person leaves the body, they won't want to stay the night in the same place. So Bhagavad Gita says, this is real knowledge, to see even during this lifetime the distinction between the body and the active principle, the self, to understand what's actually attractive, what's the animating principle of this world. And Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita teaches this process through which one comes to this perfect knowledge. He said, vidya vidu jivanam. This is the wife of all transcendental knowledge. Because when one repeats the personal names of God, then one comes naturally to a state of full knowledge and sees things as they are. And when one sees things as they are, one makes good choices in life. And when you make good choices in life, correct choices, then you go in a direction that's beneficial. And when you make bad choices in life, then you become entangled. And you do things you wish you hadn't done, because it's a mistake. So by reading this book, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, regularly, you make fewer and fewer mistakes. And you make better decisions regularly. And by doing that, your life becomes improved. So much so that you can see it for yourself. It's not a self-help technique. It's as if you were starving hungry, so hungry that your hands were shaking a little bit. You couldn't wait to get home. Have you ever felt this? You couldn't wait to get home so you could have a little something because you worked a little too long, you didn't feed the robot, and now it's starting to shake a little bit. And then you sit down to a good meal and you eat. Then what happens? Satisfaction is definitely there. This is called tushti. You get satisfaction. What else? Nourishment is there. Pushti. And then third thing is, you know for yourself that the hunger is going away. Nobody has to come in and give you a little certificate and say you're getting full now. You know. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that the process of sankirtan, the chanting of God's personal names, will satisfy the spiritual desires of the soul. And one will feel that natural relationship with Krishna awaken. And thirdly, one will become detached, naturally detached, not a matter of restraint. Have you ever had a bad habit you wanted to give up? Please say yes. But then you couldn't? Please say yes. Thank you. Well, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught that by this process of repeating the personal names of God, one will be able to, one will have the wherewithal to give up bad habits naturally, not by restraint, not holding oneself back and then thinking within mind, I'm not doing it, but tomorrow I could just break loose and I'll do twice as much damage as I was before. That's possible. In fact, the Srimad Bhagavatam discusses this. Sometimes people, they try to control the senses. They'll say, I'm going to fast. I won't eat anything anymore. In fact, sometimes people do this not for spiritual reasons, but because they're going to their high school reunion. And they're thinking, you know, Dilip is going to be there and, you know, he remembers me and I'm going to lose 20 pounds. I'm going to lose 20 pounds in the next week. And so you restrain yourself and you don't eat. And then the day after, and the tongue says, all right, you give me 10 times more now. You owe me. This is called bhoga tyag. It means you enjoy and then you try to renounce and it bounces back and forth. This is commonly known in the diet industry. Everybody knows this called yo-yo dieting. You become fat, then you become thin, fat, thin, fat. That's the story of material consciousness. But by repeating the transcendental names of God regularly, one gets the wherewithal to naturally withdraw one's senses from those things that are not entirely nourishing for one's soul. And therefore, one lives a completely balanced life, materially and spiritually. And that power to avoid bad habits and to dissolve those that have already been ingrained comes from a higher source. And so Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita teaches the step-by-step process to overcome these various bad habits that occupy our heart and our mind and that take us in directions that even we ourselves don't want to go. But we're forced to go. So it's a very powerful process. So this is taught by Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. Now we have an exciting experiment to try, and that is to move up by 7.2 inches because more and more people, our brethren from Silicon Valley, are coming in. If you see a seat open in front of you, please feel free to take it. If it's not taken in front of you now, you grab it. And you can notice just by moving up by 7.2 inches, the atmosphere changes. Okay, so I'm going to talk a little bit about determination because I've talked so far about some basic principles, which are is just a summary of what's in this book, this Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, which is a rare book. It's a very rare book. It's written in Bengali. In fact, Bengal was the 500 years ago was the seat of learning. People would come to Bengal from all over the world to study logic, spiritual knowledge, and so forth. And some of the greatest scholars in the world resided in Bengal. And some of the great acharyas wrote in Bengali. This has a combination of Bengali and Sanskrit. And of course, our founder Acharya took the trouble to translate the Sanskrit and Bengali verses into English. And he gave a word-for-word definition throughout, so that people throughout the Western world, that was his mission. That was to make these teachings, these specific teachings available to people in the West. And so far it's been a big hit. Since 1970, when the summary of this book came out, which is called Teachings of Lord Chaitanya, actually 1968 it came out. It was printed in Japan, first book, by Dai Nippon. They're still there, Dai Nippon printers. Then shipped back to America. When it hit the streets of New York and San Francisco, Santa Fe, New Mexico, Montreal, Canada, all over the West, it became immediately popular because it's applicable in everyone's lives. It's a very practical teaching that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave and which is explicated in this book, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita. So one of the important features to advance in spiritual life, an important quality, I should say, is determination. And the question is, can one develop determination? Or is it something you're born with? Someone might claim, well, that person's very determined, but I'm not. So can you do something about that? Can you become more determined? Just imagine what you could do in your life if you were more determined. Now, in the context of spiritual life, one of the great acharyas who summarized many of the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita in a simple book called Nectar of Instruction, which we also have available. You can put one of those up here too. Nectar of Instruction. It gives the six qualities that are very important for advancing in spiritual life. And one of them is determination. And here's the claim that you can actually develop determination. It's a cultivation. It's not something that you're necessarily born with, although some people may have a little more than others, but anyone can develop it. And when you develop determination, then you can move very rapidly forward in the process of bhakti yoga. So let me give you a little bit of evidence from various bhakti scriptures about how important determination is. First of all, addressing the great opportunity that we have as human beings. In a short excerpt that I'll read, that appears in the introduction to Bhagavad Gita as it is, Srila Prabhupada, who's the author, founder, acharya of our organization, writes, "The living entity forgets what to do. First of all, he makes a determination to act in a certain way. And then he is entangled in the actions and reactions of his own karma. After giving up one type of body, he enters another type of body as we take off and put on clothes. As the soul thus migrates, he suffers the actions and reactions of his past activities. These activities can be changed when the living being is in the mode of goodness. Insanity." That is, in, next word, sanity. "And understands what sort of activities he should adopt. If he does so, then all the actions and reactions of his past activities can be changed. Consequently, karma is not eternal. Therefore, we stated that of the five items, Ishvara, that means the supreme controller, Jiva, which means the living entity, Prakriti, which is material nature, comprised of earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and ego, the inert material elements, time, which is one of the energies of God, and karma, four are eternal, whereas karma is not eternal." So this is optimistic because karma is an entangling feature of this world, the law of action and reaction. And as stated in the beginning of this excerpt, if one makes decisions that violate the laws of nature, one becomes entangled. And there are myriad descriptions of karma throughout the bhakti scriptures. Yoga Sutra gives them, the Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, great detail. The various Puranas, for instance, in the Padma Purana, Aparabdha Palam Papam Kutam Bijam Palon Mukham, Kramaneva Priliante Vishnu Bhakti Ratatmanam means that there are various stages of karma which are listed and compared to the various stages of seeds. A seed can be determined in various stages, the seed stage, then it can be slightly sprouted, then it can pop out of the ground, and then when it becomes fully manifest and produces its own fruit, then we say that's another stage of its manifestation. And in the same way, they're listed here, aprarabdha palam papam. So the various stages of karma in our life are manifested at different stages. Some of them are unseen. They haven't quite come up in our life yet. In fact, the scriptures say there's so much karma for any given living entity in this world that he or she cannot experience it in one lifetime. In fact, you have to get one of those, what is it, extra storage they have. Like for all your stuff, you have all the stuff, and then it doesn't fit anymore, so then you said, let's get some extra storage, and then you put it all, that fills up. So all your karma, you have some storage locker off somewhere. So even when you finish this life, if you tried all your karma, you can't experience in this life, there's more waiting life after life. So it's very complicated process. However, Vishnu Bhakti Ratatmanam, the Bhakti scripture Padma Purana says that through the process of Bhakti Yoga, one can eliminate all karma if you make some voluntary changes in your life. And that requires determination because it's not so easy to make voluntary changes. One may decide one day I'm going to make a change in my life and then the next day you do the opposite. Has that ever happened to you? Please say yes. Thank you very much. Just so I feel better. So one has to have determination. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, naming elements of determination, here's two elements of determination so you can discern whether you're developing in your life or not, determination. This is an epic verse from the Bhagavad Gita 2:15. Yam hina vyatayantye te purusham purusharshabha samadhuka sukham dhiram somratatvaya kalpate. O best among men, Arjuna, the person who is not disturbed by happiness and distress and is steady in both is certainly eligible for liberation. So the two elements that Krishna lists here for those who become free from karma, that's what liberation means. Karma is like a debt. And when you're debt-free, you have a big celebration because, hey, no more debt. I don't have to work anymore. Karma means work. And why do you work? Because you owe something. So when you become free from debt, you're no longer obligated to work. That's liberation. So somritatvaya kalpate. Amritatvaya means that you actually get some amrita. It means freedom from death. It also means something that tastes really good. The two elements are sama. Everyone say sama. Sama. And dhiram. So sama means to be steady. It means to be unaltered. And it means that no matter what happens to you in your life, you stay the same. So the test is, the special test, you're driving on the 101 freeway, minding your own business. Person doesn't signal, doesn't use his signal, and he moves right in front of you. What do? Are you sama?
No.
No. Okay, work on it. Sama means your countenance, your way of looking at the other person doesn't change. He doesn't become instantly your enemy. You don't utter epithets against him suddenly because the person cut you off. That's probably the best example I can give because it's the hardest thing to be immune from. And the dhiram, Dhira means, here it's given as patient. So dhira means undisturbed. There are many ways in which we can become disturbed in this world, sometimes dramatically. Name three ways that one's life can be dramatically and suddenly disturbed. I know it's not such a pleasant topic, but what can be done? Kanka, one way.
A huge sinkhole in the road that you always take to go to the doctor, to go to the shopping, go to the beach, to... The yeah. sinkhole's the opposite way.
Could generally. Be worse. Could be. The sinkhole could be under your house. I mean, that happens to some people. Okay, sinkhole. Yes. What else? Yes. We need a mic in the front row. Here it comes. Great disturbances for 200.
The death of a family member?
Death of a family member is very, very difficult. It's practically impossible to avoid having heavy heart, a very disturbed mind. Therefore, even in the Vedas, in the regulations for doing temple worship, if somebody in your family dies, there's a contamination period. The reason that's there is because it's assumed that when someone in your family dies, that your mind and heart will be so disturbed that you won't actually be able to concentrate on your worship. So they say, stay away for 2 weeks. Very difficult to do that. I heard Srila Prabhupada speaking about this specific topic. When somebody in your family dies, a loved one dies, the one antidote is tolerance. Simply have to tolerate. Tolerance is a discipline that is marked by this dhira, the ability to tolerate. So sama and dhira, these are two elements that are very important. And you can keep these in mind because Krishna repeats them throughout the Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam as well. They're universal. If you learn to be equal in all various phases of your life, and you also learn to tolerate, even in the midst of greatly disturbing events that occur in your life, then Krishna says, kalpate, amritatvaya kalpate. Kalpate means you become eligible. What makes you eligible? That you're able to tolerate and you're able to remain sama, or equal, amidst all kinds of changes and all kinds of catastrophic events. So these are two basic principles that are foundational principles, elements of determination. And then Krishna tells the antithesis, what is it that undermines our determination? And he gives this in the Bhagavad Gita 2:45, Bhogaishvarya prasaktanam tayapriti prahita chetasam vyavasayatmika buddhir samadau na vidyate. So everyone's probably heard the word samadhi. Everyone say samadhi. So dhi means to meditate, and samadhi means to be in a perfect, unmoved meditation. In other words, this is, if you read the Yoga Sutra, will define the perfection of the process as the ability to fix one's mind without having it waver in one place or another. And in the sixth chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna talks about how the perfect yogi is, her mind is compared to a candle flame in a room that has no wind, and therefore the candle flame is perfectly undisturbed. So perfectly undisturbed mind. So what disturbs the mind? What takes one away from that ability to be sama and dhira? Krishna says here, bhoga aishvarya prasaktanam. So prasaktanam means to be attached to something. And what is it attached to? Bhoga means sense enjoyment. To try to enjoy the senses more and more. And the other is aishvarya. The idea that the more wealth I get, the happier I'll become. These two attachments take away from one's ability to be samadhi, or perfectly fixed in consciousness. So wealth is a flickering thing. That's why it's called chanchala. Lakshmi doesn't stay with any one person. right? Everyone wants Lakshmi. Lakshmi is the source of all wealth. So everyone worships Lakshmi in one form or another. Everyone, please Lakshmi, come to my house. But she doesn't stay for very long. Moves from one place to the next. So if you become attached and you think, oh, this is the basis of my identity, how much wealth I have, then we'll be very disturbed. And bhoga, Krishna says, this trying to enjoy the senses is the source of misery, actually. Not that there's... this means inordinate sense enjoyment. Krishna says elsewhere in the Bhagavad Gita that you should live a healthy life. You should do everything that you need for your senses to be healthy. But trying to enjoy the senses for their own sake is the source of misery. He says, yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukha yonaya evate. It's the womb of misery. That's where misery is born, when I try to find happiness through interaction with the senses. So these are two counterposed verses. One shows that sama and dhira are the basis of determination, and then bhoga aishvarya prasaktanam, attachment to sense enjoyment and to opulence, aishvarya, disturb our determination in spiritual life. Does everyone accept this basic premise before I move forward? Is that all right? Yes. We want to hear the antithesis so we can come back to the synthesis. Do we dare give him a microphone? Go ahead, give it to him.
I'm particularly interested if you can provide some examples on disturbed by happiness part of it. Distress, we all get disturbed, but how not to be disturbed in happiness? Because I have a feeling that they're kind of related, in the sense a person who gets disturbed by happiness means overjoyed.
Yeah, well, there's an old saying, thank you for your question, even in the secular world, one great self-help guru used to say that things are never as good as they seem or as bad as they seem. Have you ever heard that? Something happens, you get a great windfall of money, and then what's the next thing that happens? The government wants half. You have to keep in mind, along with, it's actually for those who have analyzed the material world completely and look at it dispassionately from a long view perspective, from a higher view up, see that happiness and distress are simply two sides of the same coin. Sorry for the cliche. But the fact is that whether it's in happiness or distress, it's simply an energy of the material world that doesn't actually satisfy the soul. And those who know this are not elated when they get some kind of favorable situation in the material world. And they're not overly distressed when they get some so-called disadvantage in the material world, because they're basically the same thing. Same kind of energy. So, here are 10 ways to achieve determination. Sorry, it's 10, but I'll go through them quickly. The first one, and these are practical, is to work from your natural strength. You have to have a natural strength in your life. And I'll read a couple passages, from Srila Prabhupada's teachings. And the first one is a verse from the Bhagavatam, 1:6:26. From Narada Muni's teachings, he writes, he spoke this to his spiritual, to his disciple, Srila Vyasadeva. Thus I began chanting the holy name and fame of the Lord by repeated recitation, ignoring all the formalities of the material world. Such chanting and remembering of the transcendental pastimes of the Lord are all benedictory. So doing, I travel all over the earth, fully satisfied and freed from pride and envy. Srila Prabhupada writes, the life of a sincere devotee of the Lord is thus explained in a nutshell by Narada Muni, by his personal example. Such a devotee, after his initiation by the Lord or his bona fide representative, takes very seriously chanting of the glories of the Lord and traveling all over the world, so that others may also hear the glories of the Lord. Such devotees have no desire for material gain. They are conducted by one single desire, to go back to Godhead. This awaits them in due course on quitting the material body. Because they have the highest aim of life, going back to Godhead, they are never envious of anyone, nor are they proud of being eligible to go back to Godhead. Their only business is to chant and remember the holy name, fame, and pastimes of the Lord, and according to personal capacity, to distribute the message for others' welfare without motive of personal gain. So I'll just reemphasize the according to personal capacity, because each person starts from their own unique situation. If you've ever been to a yoga class where they're teaching hatha yoga, you'll notice the teacher always says, don't compare yourself to others. Just do what you can naturally in every asana. And in a similar way in bhakti, we can't compare ourselves to others. We have to see what is our situation now and what is our capacity for bhakti right now. And this is our point of strength. When we identify our capacity to perform devotional service, we're acting in strength. There might be a tendency to say others are have a greater capacity than me, therefore I won't do anything. Because I don't have a great enough capacity, therefore I won't do anything. However, it's always best, in my humble opinion, to not to neglect to do what you can just because you can't do everything. Don't neglect to do what you can do right now. Even if you're starting to develop physical health, let's just say you let yourself go over maybe 40 years. Didn't do anything for your health. And then suddenly you realize, oh, the doctor just told me, and this is in the report, that if I don't get my health together, I'm going to die very soon. So then you say, well, what can I do? So you could take a walk around the block. And you say, well, that's nothing, because I have so far to go. But where are you going to? Where else will you start? You can't go climb a mountain. So at least do that. At least start to eat fruit rather than Hershey's Kisses or whatever it is. You have to start with what you can do. And this is identifying your capacity and say, according to my capacity, I'll start. There's a whole science in Japan that deals with tiny steps. And that if you identify the smallest step that you can take now, then you'll be motivated to take it. Also, the great organization guru who wrote the book Getting Things Done bases his teachings on this principle that you have to find out what's the very next step that you can take in any activity. Don't project forward and say, okay, I want to build a building, but I'll never do it. I know people have doing that throughout their whole life because they have a grandiose plan and they can't take the next step. They don't take the next step towards building that big palace they've talked about. Therefore, they don't move. So you have to find your capacity and then act in that capacity. Srila Prabhupada writes in 8.2.30, I'm just giving an excerpt from a purport. He says, therefore, because of being pulled into the water and fighting for many long years, the elephant became diminished in his mental, physical, and sensual strength. And this is about the story of Gajendra, who was dragged into the water by an crocodile and was fighting for his life and couldn't get free. And lost his strength, even though he is such a strong animal. And Prabhupada continues, the crocodile, on the other hand, being an animal of the water, increased in enthusiasm, physical strength, and sensual power. So, in his purport, Prabhupada writes, the soldiers in this Krishna consciousness movement must always possess physical strength, remain sama, even when that door slams. That's my challenge. Physical strength, enthusiasm, and sensual power. What are the three? Yeah, you have to have these things to be determined. To keep themselves fit, they must therefore place themselves in a normal condition of life. What constitutes a normal condition will not be the same for everyone, and therefore there are divisions of Varnashram, Brahman, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra, Brahmachari, Grihastha, Vanaprastha, and Sannyas. Those are listing the various divisions of Varnashram. But the point here is that you have to find your natural condition of life where you have this strength and enthusiasm through it, by which you can move forward. So if you take on too much, then you will be overly challenged and you won't be able to have the determination you need to go forward. If you take on too little, you will also not be stimulated enough to move forward. You have to find your natural strength. That means your present capacity to perform. So that's number one. Just a little more evidence in that point. In his book, The Transcendental Diary, which is written by Harisari Prabhu, who wrote about his time with Prabhupada as his servant over several years. One of the statements that Prabhupada wrote down about the priorities that one should keep in devotional service, in this order: health, sadhana, service, and reading. So first came health, and it doesn't mean that we should drop everything just to take care of our health, but if you don't stay healthy, you won't be able to perform devotional service very well. You won't have much capacity. So you have to prioritize and stay in a position of strength. Number one is find your position of strength. This is the 10 items for developing determination. Number two, choose deliberate practice over luck. Choose deliberate practice over luck. What is luck? Luck is success or failure apparently brought by chance rather than one's own actions, according to the dictionary. Just comes, I just got lucky, happened by chance. My friend Bhubaneshwar Prabhu, who has been cooking in Vrindavan for many, many years, whenever I visit him, he usually invites me over and offers me some of the prasadam that he's cooked for the noon offering for Krishna Balaram. And whenever I say, oh yeah, that was really good, I think there was some, this is good, that was really nice, he goes, yeah, it just happened by chance. I said, was the cashews in there? Yeah, they fell in. They just fell in. He has a very dry humor. things don't happen by chance, actually, because every soul, every living entity is the hallmark of being alive is that you have choice. You have volition. That's exciting. It means you can change. And so deliberate. You have to have deliberate practice. Everyone say deliberate practice. So this deliberate practice is one of the ways in which you develop determination, deliberate practice. Don't leave it to luck. Only slackers leave it to luck. It's like, oh, if it happens, it happens. No, you have to deliberately practice. There are directions how to do that. So deliberate means that it's something that's thoroughly considered. Thoroughly consider what practice you're doing. Be aware of the consequences for your actions. Have you ever been unaware of your consequences, then tried to plead, you know, I didn't know? It's you still get the reaction. You still get the reaction. And third is slow, steady, and allowing time to mature. These are the three elements of being deliberate. So here's three foundational practices for bhakti. One is numerical strength. You have to have numerical strength to move forward. Numerical strength means you count how much you're doing every day. Someone may say, well, that's material. Well, Narada Muni says, when you have a thorn stuck in your side, you have to use a thorn to take it out. So in a similar way, we use what appear to be material principles in order to advance spiritually. So in a similar way, the Goswamis of Vrindavan are heralded as having counted all of their processes of devotional service. In the great prayer, the Sad Goswami Ashrakam, Sankhya Purvaka Namagana Natibi. They counted every day how much they did. They marked it. And if you meet somebody who's chanting, for instance, a very advanced person who's every day chanting on beads, and then you see they have a little string on the side of their bead bag. We call these bead bags. They keep the beads inside. And a little string on the side that has a whole set of little, what they call counter beads. What are those for? A simple answer. What are they for? Counting. Yeah, that's right. It's Sankhya. Sankhya means to count. You have to count. If you're not counting, you're not doing foundational practice in devotional service. You're not serious. You're floundering. So in order to be determined, according to your capacity, it doesn't mean you have to do more than everybody else or as much as everybody else, but according to your capacity, you have to count. This is numerical strength, and you have to keep it every day. This develops determination. The second point is that you have to have good association, because association will develop your determination. And you can experiment with this, although I don't advise doing it downwardly, because if you associate with people who aren't interested or who have bad habits, you just pick them up. You will pick them up, guaranteed. Krishna says it over and over again in the Bhagavad Gita. According to your association, you'll develop various qualities. So if you want to have a determined practice, or actually a deliberate practice, then deliberately choose your association. And by these two elements, that is, by numerical strength and by deliberately choosing your association, you will develop determination very quickly. Here's an interesting excerpt from a conversation Prabhupada had with one of his senior leaders in the Krishna consciousness movement that goes to this principle of deliberate practice and that how we are agents for change. Should I read it? Okay. All right. Atreya Rishi, he used to be the GBC in San Francisco. At that time, there were four restaurants at the same time. It was really nice. How many qualifications does a spiritual master have? How many qualifications does a spiritual master have in terms of being a spiritual master? Prabhupada, one qualification. He is a devotee of God. That's all. Atreya Rishi, also, is he designated? Prabhupada, huh? Atreya Rishi, does he have to be designated by the former spiritual master? He has to be devotee. Prabhupada, oh yes, yes. Atreya Rishi. Surrendered. Atreya Rishi, surrendered and designated. That is, identifies disciplic succession, both surrender and designation. Prabhupada, and by the result. Atreya Rishi. Are you able to follow this so far?
Yes.
Okay. And the result of activity. Prabhupada, so far designation is concerned, the spiritual master authorizes every one of his disciples. But it is up to the disciple to carry out the order, able to carry out or not. It is not that spiritual master is partial. He designates one and rejects another. He may do that. If the other is not qualified, he can do that, but actually his intention is not like that. He wants that each and every one of his disciples become as powerful as he is, or more than that. That is his desire. Just like father wants every son to be as qualified or more qualified than himself. But it is up to the student or the son to raise himself to that standard. Atreya Rishi, I understand. Prabhupada, if you are incapable of raising yourself to the standard of becoming spiritual master, that is not your spiritual master's fault. That is your fault. He wants, just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, Amara Gaya Guru Hana, by my order, every one of you become guru. Now, if you cannot carry out the order of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then how can you become guru? The first qualification is you must be able to carry out the order of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, then he becomes guru. So that carrying out the order of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu depends on one's personal capacity. So if you have a small capacity, but you utilize it, you deliberately practice, then you come to the standard. From whatever situation you're in, if you're if you apply these principles of deliberate practice. And I bring this in to prove that it's a choice of each individual to apply this deliberate practice principle. It's not that it happens by chance. The order is there, but it cannot be imposed upon you by Krishna or a spiritual master or anyone else. You have to decide. You have to say, yes, I'm going to take it. And from there, determination and advancement in devotional service take place. Number three is to avoid distractions. Distraction is a thing that prevents someone from giving full attention to something else. So one simple way to do this is to make a list of the distractions that are in your life. So let's name a couple. What is it? iPhone. Okay, iPhone. What else? Facebook. Facebook. Okay, what else? Instagram. What else? Internet. Huh? Newspaper. Okay, so very practically, I mean, you can say these things out loud, but if you, and they may be forthcoming because you may have a complete awareness of what may be distraction, be distracting you. If you make a list of distractions, then you have every chance of eliminating them. If you leave them floating in your life, then they can consume up to 80% of your time without you even being aware of it. So this is one of the ways to develop determination is to list all the distractions in your life and then narrow your choices, which is number four. Identify what distracts you and stay committed to avoiding it. And one of the ways to do that is to plan every day in advance. And before I go on to the next principles for developing determination, I'm going to take some reflections. That is, anything that you heard so far that stuck in your mind. Right here in the front row. I'm sure we can find a microphone out there somewhere. There you go, Mukarvin.
Thank you, Maharaj, for the powerful principles you mentioned. And one of the items that you are telling, that luck versus deliberate practice versus luck. And I remember one of the bhakti notes that you sent, I think you saw a poster in some airport about an overnight success of some football star or something. Then you mentioned that how it just doesn't happen overnight.
Yeah, he said, it took me 20 years to be an overnight success. That was the advertisement. He was advertising some athletic shoe, and he was a famous athlete, and he said, it took me 20 years to be an overnight success. So yes, this is an element of a determination, is to apply oneself over time to come to the goal. What else? Yes. Second row, we're moving back row by row.
So the point that you mentioned, that karma is not eternal, because VLCs can change karma, because karma stops us from attaining
VLCs our goal. Means voluntary life changes, right?
Yes, okay. Thank you.
Yeah, just hearing that can actually give one a jolt of enthusiasm. Karma is not eternal. You don't have to stay in debt. In fact, anybody who's been in great financial debt knows that once you meet with a financial planner who looks at everything and says, okay, I know you're in a lot of debt, it's kind of serious, but there is a way out. Here's what you have to do. You have to save this much more, start paying off your debt here, you have to, you know, do this and that. And once you have that plan in mind, then you'll walk out of the office going, all right, I feel better again. If you just leave it and let it slide for the rest of your life, then there are serious consequences to that. Not just for you, but for the next generation also. It's interesting because I've seen when people leave this world, it's not over. Like Tom Petty said, you can walk away, but it's not over. There's a way in which people leave behind them their debt for their other people. So those who are in the mode of goodness and transcendental, they take care of it before they leave. So this is one of the elements of a spiritual practice, to be vigilant about taking care of your debts, including karmic debts. Yes.
Prabhu, I like the point that you mentioned that because you can't do everything doesn't mean that you can't take the first step. And I remember reading this quote that a 1,000-mile journey starts with the first step.
Yes.
So that's, I don't know if that's correct, but.
Yeah. Journey of 1,000 miles starts with one step. It's good to remember, because what else can you do? You can't go 1,000 steps at one time. You have to take the one step. Yes.
You mentioned 2 good things for determination is Sama and Dhira, and 2 bad things for determination is Bhoga and Aishwarya.
That's right, yeah. What else? 2 more. 1, 2.
Knowing your strength and performing according to your own capacity.
Yes. Thank you.
Hare Krishna, I like the point being naturally detached and how we need a higher source for that. Mm. That was very nice.
Yes. Non-attachment comes from having a higher taste. And that comes from a higher source. So Bhagavatam says, Vasudeve Bhagavati Bhakti Yoga Prayojita Janayatya Shuvairagyam Jnanam Chayarahaitukam. By performing bhakti, especially repeating the personal names of God and reading this book, Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, very quickly, one develops knowledge and detachment. What else? Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. I like the point where you said numerical strength and good association will help you.
Yeah. If you just depend on those 2 things, a numerical strength according to your capacity, and seek good association, and eschew bad association, which is pretty much the other side of the coin. Just on based on those 2 principles, you can develop determination and advance very quickly. Yes.
The 4th point you mentioned, narrowing your choices.
Yes.
Like there could be many, many choices, but
that's
you have
right.
to narrow your choices.
Narrow your choices. It won't hurt you. Identify what distracts you and stay committed to avoiding it. Give your mind fewer choices to make and plan each day in advance. If you do those 3 things, then it's very helpful in avoiding distractions. Number 5, become deeply committed. That means to make a solid, well thought out plan. If you have a plan and you're working from a plan, then you can stay determined. And that includes working from a list. Don't just take things as they come, but have a clear list that you're working from. And then you can stay determined. You can stay regulated. Narrow your choices. Number 5, become deeply committed. Next one is work within the laws. So obey the laws of good health and self-discipline, which are the bridges that connect your intentions to your achievements. So the fact is that there are various laws in this world that are inexorable. And you have to find out what they are and abide by them. Because when you violate the laws of nature, or the laws of the state, then you find yourself in a heap of trouble. And that stymies your advancement in devotional service. Number 7 is adhere to your high personal values. Identify what they are. And I'll give you an example of ways in which you can do this. These are very specific and they're very personal. One is that I've thought about recently and have put forward in my mind and heart as an important value, which is to not talk about people behind their backs. If they're not present and you're not talking about something laudatory or constructive, then avoid talking about them. And the second thing is to not talk about politics. They're just personal things. But I've noticed that these two things can occupy up to 80% of my 24 hours in a day if I allow them to. Because politics is an unlimited issue that has no real resolution, because things are always in a fluid state. And you can become, by their very nature, there's two poles. That's why they're called politics. And you can be constantly drawn back and forth, sometimes in the middle, drawn this way, drawn that way, and the opinions bounce back and forth. And if you get into that force field, if you enter into that energy, your whole mind and energy can be consumed, and you can lose your determination in devotional service. It can become a strong value to not speak about things that you can't do anything about. And then not talking about others behind their back. If you make that value in your life and you adhere to it, you'll notice, or at least I've noticed, that the tongue generally wants to talk about people when they're not there in various ways. And if I just take that option away by keeping this strong value that I won't talk about other people behind their back, then I get strong determination to continue in my devotional practice. I'm less distracted. Number eight is to realign your actions regularly, your actions and your goals. You have to constantly come back to it and look and see, what did I design and why am I following it? Because the tendency is to lose track and move on to something else through association, through the influence of time. So you have to continually realign. And realize also, we only have 60, 80, 100 years anyway to complete this process. So take time to realign regularly. And number nine, take action now. When you design your plan, remember that you can only do it at this present moment. You have to take advantage of the moment that you're in now. Don't wait till next year, next week, but do something now. And remember that even the smallest action now adds up over time. And finally, don't forget the finish line. You have to keep your goal in sight all the time. And the more that you do that, the more that you define what your goal is, and you keep it in front of you visibly, the more determined you will be and the less distracted you will be in devotional service. Om Tat Sat. Now just take a couple more reflections, and then we have the benefit of having a few minutes to chant the Maha Mantra as recommended by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Radha Kripa.
Well, Maharaj, thank you very much for your wonderful class. I have a question specific to the not speaking behind the back. Does it also include the glorification? Sometimes when you speak highly about their sadhana or something, so that is allowed.
Nope, doesn't refer to that.
Okay. Thank you.
That's okay. Won't hurt you. But anything short of that will.
So, these 10 principles seem quite comprehensive. Thank you for that. And I think the first principle, like finding your position of strength, and the ninth is act now, are somewhat related, because if you either become too grandiose about yourself, then you won't be able to act now because you don't have that strength. So,
yeah, nice
so they're
point.
Kind of related.
Yeah, it's you have to be humble and do what you can now. Don't try to, don't make a pretense to be more than you are. Do what you can honestly right now and steadily, and you'll advance from that position. That's okay. But I also mentioned don't do less, because you can't also take that as an excuse. No one can claim to be permanently unqualified. That's also illegal. Was one more? Yes, Kanka.
Thank you for your wonderful class. And welcome back from Yatra.
Thank you.
When you were talking about it's good not to talk behind someone's back, I agree with you, is that that's negative talk, because we can glorify people behind their back, right?
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. The Smriti Sashas say that one should not praise or glorify, but of the two, one can neglect the second, the first, and not, and it's okay to glorify.
And I also wanted to just thank you for emphasizing these 10 principles for determination. I thought it was really inspiring.
Oh, thank you, Kanko. Then I consider whatever I've spoken to be successful if you liked it. That's my heartfelt feeling, my heartfelt realization. Hare Krishna. Natari Armarman.